Hello students, looking at current affairs for 22nd June, the news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these 17. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, amid protests, triple talaq bill introduced. So this is the Muslim Women Protection of Rights on Marriage Bill 2019. So this is also known as triple talaq bill. So the Narendra Modi government has introduced this bill in the Lok Sabha amid protests by opposition members who say that it violates the constitution. So this is the first legislation of the BJP government in the second term. Already it has made two attempts to pass this legislation in the Lok Sabha earlier, but then it stayed pending in Lok Sabha. It could not be passed in Rajya Sabha. So those bills have lapsed. So you should know about this also. Bills which have been passed by Lok Sabha and pending in Rajya Sabha lapse after the Lok Sabha gets dissolved. So because Rajya Sabha is a permanent house, it won't get dissolved. So there's a new Lok Sabha coming. So it has to be passed again by the new Lok Sabha. So you can see this voting took place. Already triple talaq, instant triple talaq, that is talaq-e-bidat as it is officially called, which the triple talaq bill also targets. That is only instant triple talaq, one form of talaq, which is talaq-e-bidat. So this has been banned by the Supreme Court in August 2017. Still, the government has gone ahead and passed this legislation saying that even after the ban, over 200 cases have been reported. So this necessitates the government to pass a bill on the issue. So Congress member Mr. Shashi Tharoor says that he is against triple talaq, instant triple talaq, but then it is already voided by the Supreme Court and the conditions imposed in the bill are, you know, against the civil and criminal laws. So it is saying that this is a textbook example of class legislation. So class legislation in the sense it is a legislation which is targeting at one community, in this case the Muslims. So you can't have a law targeting, or, you know, it's a criminal offense. It is actually a civil case, a civil aspect to it, but then it is made a criminal offense. So there is civil and criminal side. Criminal is related to all crimes and civil side is related to marriage, divorce, you know, and all those matters, inheritance, etc., adoption, etc. So that is there. And then another leader of AMIM, he says, Saadudin Owaisi, he says that the bill violates constitutional rights because it stipulates 3-year jail term for men who indulge in instant triple talaq, but a similar offense by non-Muslim men attracts only 1-year jail term. And it is claimed that a jail term for a man for divorcing his wife is legally untenable. So the Supreme Court also doesn't call for a jail term or something. It just calls it null and void. So if it is a divorce or through instant triple talaq, it's actually not a divorce. It should not be accepted. Means the couple is still married. So then if it is not applicable, only if it's not happened, if triple talaq cannot take place through that route, then how does the question arise? Because then if the person who is accused of this is behind bars, then who take care of the wife? What is it? Then again, the wife is abandoned. So the criminal offense associated with it is the question being raised. So these are the earlier attempts which have been made. Even government has passed ordinance on the act. So ordinance is something which has to be done in emergency to address the void. So you can see the pursuit which is there to pass this bill in the present government. So highlights of that bill were also, it was declared null and void, which of course the Supreme Court has also already done, but it makes it punishable offense with 3 years of punishment and fine. Then this is regarding the revised bill which was passed. Already ordinance was promulgated, you can see, in September 2018, and this revised bill was to replace that ordinance, because ordinance does not last long, it is just a temporary provision. So this revised bill brought in two important clauses. One, that it said that the woman can drop the case against her husband if both reach a compromise. So this was one provision added because of criticism. And another provision was of provision for bail, which can be granted by a magistrate only after hearing the wife. So bail provision was also added. So these were the controversial parts of the bill which we discussed, that if the husband is in jail, then it ends all possibilities of reconciliation. But that amendment provided for provisions for this. And then you have the Supreme Court ruling, the 3-2 ruling, in which Supreme Court declared this practice null and void. It did not call for any jail term on the matter, which the government has done through the legislation it has enacted, which is criticized as well. Then next is Kaleshwaram project inaugurated. So this is Kaleshwaram lift irrigation project, which is claimed to be the world's largest multi-stage, multi-purpose lift irrigation scheme. It has been inaugurated. The first barrage of the project has been completed. So it has been inaugurated by Telangana Chief Minister Chandrasekhar Rao. So it is meant to irrigate over 37 lakh acres of new and existing aquifers and supply drinking water to Hyderabad and villages en route. So the Telangana government has also requested the central government to declare the Kaleshwar lift irrigation project as a project of national importance. So if it is declared as a national project, then it will fund the cost too. So it Telangana government expects the central government to fund it entire cost. It is said it is estimated to cost 88,000 crore rupees. So it says that it has started off with the mega project. The cost of it is being met through borrowings by the Kaleshwar Corporation. But the debt servicing, it says the burden is huge, and the state has requested center to grant the project a national status. So the project is going to benefit the combined state of Andhra Pradesh, means Andhra Pradesh and Telangana both. Also, it reminds that the Niti Aayog has recommended special assistance of 19,205 crore to Mission Bhagiratha. So this is intended to supply pipe drinking water to every household in Telangana and Andhra. And also another mission is Mission Kakatiya. So it is meant to restore 45,000 tanks in Telangana. So the project missions which have been initiated, because when Telangana was formed as a separate state, there was a need to provide it assistance to make it an independent state with taking care of itself in a full-fledged manner. So state had sought assistance from the center, and for this Kaleshwar project also it needs assistance. Plus it also calls for assistance of 50 crore to each of the backward districts, which have been promised under the Andhra Pradesh Reorganization Act, the act under which Andhra Pradesh was bifurcated into present-day Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. So it has urged that this package of 50 crores for each backward district should be extended to all districts of the state, because the erstwhile 9 districts have now been divided into 32 districts. So this is the demand being made by the state government of Telangana. Then next is Operation Bandar, codename of Balakot strike. So this is the Balakot strike which Indian Air Force undertook in to attack the terrorist training camp in Balakot in Pakistan. So the code name for this strike now has been known to be Operation Bandar. So Operation Bandar, it was not known by this name to many, only few knew about it. Even complete secrecy was maintained about the project. The Mirages which attacked Balakot in Pakistan, they also took off directly from their home base in Gwalior at the time of the mission. So they crossed Himachal Pradesh and Kashmir to enter into Pakistan. So this was a secret mission, and it was in response to the Pulwama terror attack, which claimed the lives of 40 security personnel. So in response to that, the Balakot airstrike, that is Operation Bandar, was initiated, in which 12 Indian Air Force Mirage 2000 fighter jets struck the Jaish-e-Mohammed training camp in Balakot inside Pakistan on 26th. So there were precision guided munitions which were used on these Mirage 2000s. So this is Balakot, the location shown here. You can see across the LOC, across the international border in Pakistan. So this is the international border shown in red, and this is the LOC in Jammu and Kashmir shown here in dotted lines. So these were the Mirage 2000, which is a French multi-role single engine fighter jet, which is capable of dropping a range of bombs and missiles, including laser guided bombs. So they are fitted with Thales radar, which can strike at targets with 100% accuracy. Then next is Madrasa teacher attacked for not saying Jai Shri Ram. So this is a case which has come forth, one of the many cases which are being heard of now, that a Madrasa teacher who was allegedly hit by a car because he refused to say Jai Shri Ram. So this incident took place in Rohini in Delhi. So he was asked by men in the car to repeat some words which were written on a sticker pasted on the vehicle, and when he refused, he was hit by the car. So police have registered a case under section 323 of IPC and have started investigating the incident. Then next is Islamic State was initially unaware of Easter attacks. So these are the Easter terror attacks which took place in Sri Lanka. So it is said the Islamic State claimed responsibility for the attacks, but also the responsibility was claimed with much delay. After 48 hours after the April 21 attacks, Islamic State claimed responsibility for these attacks, in which over 250 lives were lost. So Islamic State, it is said that it did not know of the attacks earlier. So it was actually a local Islamist radical, Zahran Hashim, about whom we have discussed quite often. So he was the one who was behind this attack, the leader behind the attack, and he was an IS sympathizer. So he had contacted the IS leadership after the attacks. So But then there, the Islamic State was initially unaware of the Easter attacks. So after that, it got aware and it claimed responsibility. Then next is GST Council eases returns filing process. So this is regarding GST Council's 35th meeting, the first meeting under new finance minister Nirmala Sitharaman. So here the meeting took several decisions, of which the important ones are that it aims to ease the registration of GST and returns filing process. So it has allowed use of Aadhaar for registrations, and introduction of e-invoicing has been set off, and a deadline has been brought in for rollout of single return filing system, only one returns filing. So this process has been initiated and a deadline has been set for it. So you can see Aadhaar can now be used as identity and address proof for registration under GST. Also the e-invoicing is possible. Also with respect to earlier decisions, now it has been put into law. That is, that turnover threshold for GST registration has been raised to 40 lakh a year from 20 lakh earlier. The decision was already taken in earlier GST meetings, but now it has been approved into law. So earlier decisions have been approved into law. One is about turnover threshold for GST registration increase, and the composition scheme has been extended to services. So we should know about the composition scheme too. It was earlier for goods, now it is also for services. It was there for services only for restaurant services. You can see a composition scheme is basically for those whose turnover is not enough to have GST registrations being made through the entire stringent process. So what is done is they claim, they do not give the entire invoicing. So they claim GST rate at a nominal rate. They pay GST at a nominal rate, which is, you can see, for manufacturers excluding notified goods, it is a GST rate of only 2%. And for other eligible suppliers, it is a GST rate of 1%. And also restaurant services are included, which is at a GST rate of 5%. So this is GST rate for goods basically, and only restaurant services. But now it has been extended to all services. So composition scheme, there's a threshold also for small businesses as such. So this is the composition scheme. So this is the composition scheme, which has now been extended into services. It was already extended. That's what we discussed. The decision was already taken. The council has approved this into law. And then also the introduction of e-invoicing system in a phased manner will be initiated. The phase one will be voluntary and would roll out from 1st Jan 2020. So it will remove the burden of generating e-way bills. So e-invoicing would be allowed. So this is another change which has been brought in by the GST Council. And also the tenure of National Anti-Profiteering Authority has been extended by 2 years. So we have already discussed about National Anti-Profiteering Authority 2 days back. Then next is over 12,000 suicide deaths by farmers in 3 years. So this has been admitted in the Maharashtra Legislative Assembly. It says despite spending over 19,000 crore on farm loan waiver, a total of 12,021 farmers have died in Maharashtra. So these were suicides from 2015 to 2018. It is said in 2019, in the first 3 months itself, 610 deaths of farmers have occurred. So Chief Minister Devendra Fadnavis had earlier also told the House that over 50 lakh farmers would be benefited from the loan waiver scheme, and 24,000 crores will be spent for this by the state government. So of the total number of 50 lakh farmers which were to be benefited, it is said 43.32 lakh farmers have actually received benefits worth 19,000 crore rupees. So government has spent this much, and that's what they're trying to say. These are populist schemes. These are for present one-time benefit, and they are not going to be long-lasting. So government is here showing how the farmers that still continue even after the loan waiver scheme. So as per the reply in the Maharashtra Legislative Assembly, Maharashtra Chief Minister Devendra Fadnavis has given this viewpoint. Also, it was said that out of the 12,021 farmer suicides, total of 6,888 cases qualified for compensation as per the norms. And of these, out of these, skin of farmers of 6,845 cases have been paid rupees 1 lakh 8. So they were paid rupees 1 lakh 8, but it is clear it was not sufficient. In 2019, also it is said of the 610 cases, till now only 192 cases are eligible for compensation and 96 were declared ineligible. So rest cases are pending for inquiry and suicide deaths have already taken place. So this is there. So the norms to decide whether a person committing suicide was a farmer has been changed in 2006 to give compensation to the deceased. So this has been looked into. So an RTI application was also filed giving asking for details of farmers who committed suicide from the year 2014 to 2018, and government has given these details, you can see. So number of farmers' deaths and number of farmers eligible for compensation are shown. So these many farmers were eligible for compensation, still they have committed suicide. This is a significant number. Then next is detention of farmer sparks row in council. So this is a legislative council of Maharashtra. So Maharashtra has a legislative assembly as well as a legislative council. Otherwise we have unicameral legislation in all states except six actually. So the legislative council is the upper house. The way we have Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha at the legislature at the central level, at state level there is only one house, unicameralism. That is only legislative assembly, but few states have legislative council, which includes Maharashtra, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Andhra, Telangana also are new latest states who have legislative council, and Jammu and Kashmir also has a legislative council under its own constitution. So the legislative council of Maharashtra, there were, you can see here, a farmer protesting against the government's failure to implement the loan waiver scheme has been arrested. He was protesting here and it rocked the proceedings of the Legislative Council of Maharashtra. This was the this is a farmer named Ashok Manwar. He is from Vashim district in Maharashtra. He was detained by security personnel when he tried to enter the assembly and demanded full amount promised by none other than Chief Minister Devendra Fadnavis in October 2017. He says, I have got 1.4 lakh grant. But he was promised 1.4 lakh grant but has received only 77,437, and all he was demanding was when would he pay, when would he be paid the remainder amount. So his arrest resulted in opposition demanding suspension of the police officers involved. Then next is bill on Maratha quota passed by both houses. So Maharashtra Legislative Council has passed a bill to amend the Socially and Economically Backward Class Act. So this is an act which will ensure 16% reservation to students of Maratha community in postgraduate medical admissions. So the Legislative Council has passed this bill, which has already been passed by Maharashtra Legislative Assembly. So an ordinance was also there before this bill has been passed. So this ordinance was promulgated to amend the Socially and Economically Backward Class Reservation Act to provide the same 16% reservation to Maratha. So it has been a long-standing demand for reservation among the Maratha students, and this has been provided now. The community has been agitating for long for reservation in education as well as in government jobs. So here you can see the details regarding the houses which have legislative councils is given, as we discussed. It is Maharashtra, Karnataka, UP, Bihar, and also latest to Andhra and Telangana, and Jammu and Kashmir under its own constitution. So these are the seven states which have legislative council, six under the constitution of India, and Jammu and Kashmir under Jammu and Kashmir constitution. So it's the only state which has its own constitution. And when ordinance is spoken of, this is regarding the ordinance making power, which is there with the President of India at the central level and the governor of each state at the state level. So at the central level, it's Article 123 of the Constitution, which talks of promulgation of ordinance by the President. And this is done during the recess of the Parliament, means when the Parliament is not in session. So it's for a temporary period. It's a temporary law. So you can see. So when once the Parliament comes in session, the ordinance needs to be presented before it, and ordinance will expire if it's not approved by the Parliament within 6 weeks of its commencement. So the ordinance can have a life of maximum 6 weeks after the Parliament has commenced its session. So an ordinance may be issued by President when one house is in session too, because to pass a bill, both houses are required. So even if one house is in session, other is not, ordinance can be passed. An ordinance may be made under circumstances which require immediate action. So that is the original intent. Something which is immediately required, which cannot be waited for. Not something which the legislature would not pass and the executive, the government wants implemented. Then next is Supreme Court halts roadworks through tiger reserves. So the Supreme Court has ordered an immediate halt to the construction of road that passes through a corridor between Rajaji and Corbett Tiger Reserves. So these are the two tiger reserves in Uttarakhand state, and there is a corridor which has been built, construction of a road taking place, which it is said violates numerous provisions of the Forest Conservation Act too. So now the Supreme Court bench has issued notice to the Uttarakhand government and has asked it to reply within 3 weeks, and also to report, and issued a notice because of the report filed by the court appointed committee. So the court had appointed the central empowered committee, which looked into the matter, and now the Uttarakhand government has asked to respond on it. So the road traverses a critical corridor between Rajaji Tiger Reserve and Corbett Tiger Reserve, which has been built. This road has been built without the statutory approval of bodies like National Board of Wildlife and even the advice of National Tiger Conservation Authority, which is the nodal authority for tiger conservation, has not been taken. Nor permission has been taken, nor advice has been taken. Permission is required of National Board for Wildlife. So that is there. So these are the two tiger reserves in Uttarakhand. They are shown on the map here. You can see this is Jim Corbett National Park, the tiger reserve here, and this is Rajaji National Park. So a corridor road has been built here. So that passes through the both. So that's the problem. Then next is only 1 in 4 received PM Kisan money. So while the union government has expanded PM Kisan, we've heard of this news once the new government was formed, that Pradhan Mantri Kisan Samman Nidhi, it has been extended to more farmers now. So the beneficiaries have increased, but it is said that amongst the beneficiaries, intended beneficiaries, only 1 in 4 have received income support. So if you should remember, this is 6,000 rupees which will be provided as an annual sum to farmers as an income support to land-owning farmers in 3 installments of rupees 2,000 each. Of course, there is a criticism that this is only for land-owning farmers, not for landless laborers, which are further, you know, suffering. So this is for small and medium landowners. So the scheme as such, on this, the data which has been given in the Rajya Sabha, the agriculture minister himself told the Rajya Sabha about how only 1 in 4 beneficiaries have received the installments. You can see the total number of beneficiaries are 14.5 crore families. And of these, so far 3.29 crore families have received the first installment, and only 2.85 crore beneficiaries have received the second installment. So it is every 3 months, and it started off retrospectively from December period itself. So this is the detail coming forth. So it was announced in the last interim budget of the government. The next is, consider bills pending in Rajya Sabha as lapsed. So this is Vice President and Rajya Sabha Chairman. So Vice President of India is actually the ex officio chairman of Rajya Sabha. It is M. Venkaiah Naidu. He has suggested that, it's a suggestion, it's not actually true, because a bill pending in Rajya Sabha does not lapse. So a bill lapses. A bill passed by Lok Sabha but pending in Rajya Sabha lapses, as we saw presently also in the case of Triple Talak Bill. It was passed by Lok Sabha but pending in Rajya Sabha. So it has lapsed. There have been many such bills which have lapsed, like the Land Acquisition Bill, Consumer Protection Bill, the Triple Talak Bill, Citizenship Amendment Bill, which is also a prominent bill which government pursued in its last term in power. So what has happened is bills passed by Lok Sabha but pending in Rajya Sabha immediately lapse. So what the Rajya Sabha chairman is suggesting is that bills should not immediately lapse, but they should lapse if they are pending for more than 5 years. Means till 5 years they should stay alive. So but then the idea is that they immediately lapse because a new Lok Sabha would be formed. There would be new government in power, so they may not want the bill which was passed by the earlier government. So in such a scenario, it is logical that the bill lapses. But this is a suggestion which is being given by the Rajya Sabha chairman, the vice president. So he says that then the entire process of reintroducing the bill in the Lok Sabha has to take place because a new Lok Sabha has been formed. So of course they should look into the matter. Entire process has to be gone through afresh. So yes, of course it is required. Only in present scenario, when the same government has come with a huge mandate, it may seem redundant, but in general the rule prevails. So you should know about all these details too in polity. The terminologies too, like adjournment, prorogation and dissolution of the house. So adjournment of the house gets adjourned by the presiding officer. This is done by the, adjournment is done by the presiding officer, that is speaker in Lok Sabha and chairman in Rajya Sabha. Summon, prorogue and dissolve. These two are the power, three are the powers of the president. The president of India summons, prorogues and dissolves the house. But when a session is going on, adjournment of the session as such takes place by the presiding officer, respectively in Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. So that's suspending the present sitting of the house. So it does not, adjournment has no effect on bills and businesses. They all stay alive. It's just the session has been adjourned. Prorogation as such is to postpone sessions. So that is done only by president. That also does not affect any business or bill. only dissolution of the house when Lok Sabha's term ends, then the bills are affected. And you can see what happens in that time is that those bills which are pending in Lok Sabha lapse, because of course they are pending in Lok Sabha, fresh bills will be introduced, because most of the bills are introduced by the government itself. So bills pending in Lok Sabha, not come before Rajya Sabha, they lapse. Bills pending in Rajya Sabha stay alive, because Rajya Sabha has not changed after Lok Sabha is dissolved. So bills pending in Rajya Sabha stay alive. That is where Rajya Sabha is the first house. Bills passed by Lok Sabha or Rajya Sabha pending in Lok Sabha or Rajya Sabha second house, they lapse. So even a bill has been passed by Lok Sabha pending in Rajya Sabha lapses, a bill passed by Rajya Sabha but pending in Lok Sabha also lapses. And those bills which have reached the president, means passed by both the houses and reached the president, and it is pending with the president, they stay alive. And bills which have been referred to committees also, like some bills are referred to committees for detailed examination, those bills also stay alive. Then next is NIA files charge sheet against Islamic State module. So the National Investigation Agency has filed a charge sheet in special NIA court in Delhi against 10 people who were arrested from Delhi and Amroha in Uttar Pradesh in 2018 for allegedly propagating Islamic State ideology. So the accused were preparing to make remote controlled intensive explosive devices and wanted to establish an IS caliphate in India. So they were planning to resort to large scale terrorist attacks in and around Delhi. So they had named this module as Harkatul Harbe Islam. And it is said they were guided by three Islamic State handlers based abroad. So they have been arrested by NIA. The NIA has evidence, and they said that these people who have been arrested, they made use of encrypted social media app or a chat platform, indirectly maybe referring to WhatsApp, to propagate the ideas. And their mobile phones have also been recovered. The next is FATF wants Pakistan but keeps it off the blacklist. So this is Financial Action Task Force, the international organization which looks into two aspects. Terror financing and money laundering. So it has already put Pakistan in grey list, but in the present plenary meet in Orlando, Florida in USA, it did not put Pakistan in the blacklist. It still remains in the, continues to remain in the grey list. And it has given a warning to Pakistan that by the end of the plenary session, that it has to take action. The last due date which is there for Pakistan to take action on some of the action plans is October 2019. By that time, if Pakistan fails to complete its action plans, so there were three deadlines. First deadline expired in Jan 2019 when Pakistan failed to complete its action plans. The second deadline for some action plans was May 2019 when again it has failed, which has been discussed in the June meet now. And now Pakistan has completed its action plans by October 2019 when the last set of action plans are set to expire. If it does not, then FATF has warned that it may have to take stringent action. So it was in June 2018 that Pakistan was placed on FATF grey list of countries whose laws do not adequately deal with these two aspects, money laundering and terror financing. So though the FATF has agreed that Pakistan has taken steps to improve its anti-money laundering and countering terror financing as such, so the laws have been, the initiatives have been taken, but it is not sufficient. So that has been clearly stated. It is said in April 2019, Pakistan Foreign Minister had said that being grey listed could cost Pakistan $10 billion a year. So being in the grey list of the Financial Action Task Force has its consequences, and being blacklisted will further bring trouble to Pakistan economy. So to stay off the FATF blacklist, it needs support of at least three of the total 36 FATF members that are countries. So excluding two regional organizations. So these are 36 FATF members who at least three of them should support Pakistan. And FATF has continued to call for countermeasures even against Iran and North Korea. So if a country is under FATF grey list or blacklist, you can see what happens is there is decline in foreign transactions and foreign currency inflow into Pakistan. It already has a large current account deficit. Financial institutions become wary of transacting with Pakistani banks, and some might even want to avoid Pakistan altogether. So these are the consequences of being grey listed. So cost of fund also increases. You can see financial sector might take a hit as Standard Chartered, which is the largest international bank in Pakistan with 116 branches, might decide to pull out from Pakistan too, as well as other international banks like Citibank and Yosh Bank. Then next is India placed on tier 2 in human trafficking report. So this was in news yesterday too. US State Department has released its 2019 trafficking in persons report, in which it has highlighted the need for action against domestic trafficking, in which it has this tier 2 category of countries which whose governments do not fully meet the Trafficking Victims Protection Act, which is a US Act. Well, it's a US Act of 2000, the year 2000, but it talks of such trafficking victims in other countries also. So it lists down countries, it categorizes them into various tiers, and tier 2 countries are countries whose governments do not fully meet the Trafficking Victims Protection Act provisions. This is a US Act provisions. The minimum standards are not met by them, but they are making significant efforts to bring themselves into compliance. So India is amongst the tier 2 countries. So the recommendations which this report of USA puts for India include that it should amend the definition of trafficking in section 370 of Indian Penal Code to include forced labor trafficking too. It should establish anti-human trafficking units in all districts with funding and clear mandates. Also, the report says that 77% of trafficking cases are such that the victims are trafficked within the countries of residence rather than cross-border trafficking. And victims of sex trafficking are more likely to be trafficked across the borders, while victims of forced labor were typically exploited within their own country. So both these aspects have been covered in the report of USA. Then next is no cap on H-1B visa in reprisal for data norms. So the US State Department has said that it is not considering capping the number of H-1B visas for countries that adopt laws which call for data localization. So India is one of the countries, and USA has raised its concern regarding that. And H-1B visa norms have also been made stringent. But now it is said that USA is not considering capping H-1B visas for such data localization countries. That it was rumored that there will be a cap of 10 to 15% as such for such countries, which would include India, which would be adversely affecting India. But US State Department has said there is no such consideration before it. Trump administration's Buy American, Hire American executive order of April 2017 has resulted in making H-1B program also stringent. So H-1B visa is a temporary visa for employment of foreign workers in US-based firms. But then it is the route to permanent residency, that is the getting a green card in USA. So H-1B visa is quite in demand, and many Indians take up this, and it is given for those who are having highly specialized knowledge. So they require theoretical and practical application of a highly specialized knowledge. So such occupations get H-1B visas. So here you can see the congressionally mandated cap of 65,000 H-1B visas under general category is there. So but then there is no country-wise cap, and they are not going to bring in country-wise cap, has been clarified now. Then this is the list of contentious topics between India and USA. So even US Secretary of State will be on a visit to India. So these will be in news. That is data localization issue, the 5G telecommunication issue in which Huawei, the Chinese telecom companies, is targeted, and US does not want it to be involved in 5G networks in any country. So it is asking India also to exclude it from its 5G bidding process also. And again, regarding the purchase of S-400 Trump missile system, which India is buying from Russia. So it is also against it because it violates the CARTS Act, countering American adversaries through sanctions. So that is the act of USA. So it is opposing India's plan to purchase this S-400 Trump missile defense systems from Russia. And the last news is Walmart broke anti-graft rules in India elsewhere. So this is global retail giant Walmart. It has agreed to pay $282.7 million to settle charges of violation of anti-corruption regulations of the USA. So US has these Foreign Corrupt Practices Act as such in place, and multinationals have to comply with these acts even if they are indulging in business outside the country in foreign nations. So it is said that while Walmart has been operating in USA, it's initiating its operation in India, China, Brazil, Mexico, and here it has violated anti-corruption regulations while operating its business here, means even in India. So it's Walmart Bharti venture which is there, which is functioning in India, and the Security and Exchange Commission, the way we have SEBI, USA has Security and Exchange Commission, the regulatory body. According to SEC, these violations were conducted by Walmart's third-party intermediaries, not by Walmart itself. and they said they made payment to foreign government officials, these officials in these countries, India, China, Brazil and Mexico, without reasonable assurances that they are complying with the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act of USA. So that is why Walmart has been made to pay these charges for violating anti-corruption regulations. So Walmart has been charged with violation of this act and failing to operate a sufficient anti-corruption compliance program for more than a decade. So it has seen rapid international growth, but it has not ensured complying with the anti-corruption norms. And also parallel criminal charges have been imposed against Walmart by Department of Justice. So to settle these total claims, Walmart has agreed to pay $2.7 million. So this is the detail regarding that. You can see Walmart being probed for potential violation of US Foreign Corruption Practices Act in India. So these are the law firms leading the investigations in India too. And you can see it is Bharti Walmart, which has now deferred opening of new stores for the time being too. So this act is also detailed out. So this Foreign Corrupt Practices Act of USA is a 1977 law that prohibits US citizens and companies from bribing government officials in foreign countries while doing business overseas. So it is said that $35 million have been spent by Walmart in the last 18 months to strengthen FCPA compliance and probe potential violations of it. So that is it. Thank you.